I'd like to welcome you all to our Sabbath school this morning, our regular members, our visitors, and the older members who have not attended this church perhaps for many years. We'd like to welcome you on such a nice, perhaps not perfect, Sabbath morning weather, but still its weather is quite good. Yes, Royal Oaks started off as a small church and as a Sabbath school about 100 years ago. And we can see that God has been working, God has been doing miracles with this church. We'll just bow our heads for a brief prayer before we continue. Father in heaven, we thank thee again for thy many blessings. We thank you again for your leading in the past. And we know that because you've led us, you've led this church in the past, thou will continue. And we look forward to the day when Jesus comes again. We pray that we might all be taken home at that time. It's our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. I thought I would think about, share with you a little what it might have been back in 1915, 100 years ago. What was life like then? Yes, it was a troublesome time. Actually, it was during the war. It was during the First World War. They didn't call it the First World War then. Of course, they wouldn't. They eventually called it the Great War. And the saying was, this would be the war to end all wars. Sadly, this was not so. And we can see on the screen, this is what people were doing then, getting the news, reading newspapers, perhaps even more so than we do today. We have so many other means of communication. And on those newspapers, it was war stories, information about the war. Yes, a very good old-fashioned grocery shop. They didn't have the wonderful supermarkets then. This was an old general grocery shop, and perhaps some of you older folk might remember something similar. And the next one, again, people did have entertainment. I think this might have been a stadium where they were watching horse racing or perhaps sport. I'm not sure which, but people, despite the times of war, they were entertaining, had entertainments. And in the next photo, you know, back then people, New Zealanders and people in the British Empire were very loyal. People would want to serve the king and country. And this is a regiment that's marching off prior to being sent overseas to fight in the war. Of course, during this time, we had the Gallipoli campaign, and young people especially, be very keen to participate. They volunteered. During the first 2 years, 1914 and 1915, there was no conscription. All the soldiers were volunteers. See, young people, young men, believed, or the society believed as a whole, that the war would last a few months. And the young men wanted to enlist so they could travel overseas, go to Europe, perhaps even London, gain a bit of glory in fighting on the battlefields, and then come home after a few months. So young men were so keen to do them, to get in with this, go on with this, that they falsified their birth date. They made themselves older than they really were. So that was the spirit then. Again, they're off there carrying their bags. Probably, I think they're going onto a ship. But sadly, of course, eventually the reality of war, what war was, started to sink in. The Gallipoli campaign was not successful. They had to kind of just pull out of that, and they did that very successfully, actually, but there were many, many casualties in the Gallipoli campaign. But then they were shipped off, many of them who were at Gallipoli were shipped off to Europe, and they fought in the trenches. Now, ladies, they were perhaps slightly latecomers to playing tennis, but these are a group of ladies who played tennis in 1915. And you can see their dress and costumes. Perhaps it's a bit different to what it was today. Again, they're embarking on a ship there, going to Europe or Gallipoli. The hundreds and hundreds of men, of course. The next photo, again, a young man. This is the type of man who was keen to enlist, keen to volunteer to fight for his king and country. In the next photo, again, a scene from a battlefield. It didn't take long before when they were entrenched in the trenches in Europe that the terrible casualties became apparent. And at that time too, the First World War was the first time that aeroplanes were being used in warfare. Now, what did people dream about then? What did people want? This is what they wanted. A T-model Ford car. Now, it was only for the slightly better to do that could afford it. You would have to work quite a long time, perhaps a year or two, and save everything you possibly could to afford one of those. Well, it's a nice car, isn't it? It looks nice. Although, I wonder, we travel in from Helensville, 50 kilometres every Sabbath morning, and we're here on time. I'm just wondering if we did own that car, whether we could make it on time to Sabbath school. Anyway, I don't know. Probably not. Perhaps the roads weren't that best then. 1915 was also a very significant year for the church. Regarding the one more thing I'd like to bring to your attention regarding the war service in New Zealand, in Australia, and USA, and eventually in Britain, there were special concessions for Seventh-day Adventists. Officially, they could get not have to carry guns, and also some Sabbath concessions. But sometimes these were difficult to implement because different departments in the army would have to take a different stand on this. Yes, a significant year in 1915. Ellen White passed away then. Ellen White was known, of course, she wanted to call herself a messenger of the Lord. That's what she called herself. Many in our church, of course, called her a prophet. She felt that the prophet was, she didn't deserve such a high title. To the outside world, Ellen White was known as a temperance speaker, temperance campaigner. She talked about health. She especially was critical of the tragic and devastating effect of alcohol and the harmful effects of smoking. This is what she was known by to the outside world. Interestingly, she died from a fracture. She was 87 when she passed away. She had a fall. She fractured her hip, which is a common condition, mishap in especially elderly ladies. And after that, in those days, they couldn't do what we can do today. After that fracture of her hip, she could not walk anymore. So she was confined to bed or a wheelchair. Interestingly, the last message she wrote out for the church was directed at the youth. And the theme of the message was this: She would like to see our youth read good literature. I think that was significant. And the last words she spoke before she closed her eyes and passed away, actually she wasn't in pain during her last illness. She was free from pain. But the last words that she spoke was this: I know whom I have believed. I know whom I have believed. And those were the last words that she spoke. And then she passed away. Yes, the church has progressed over the years since 1915. I just took out some figures there. In 1915, the world membership had about 147,000. In 2015, it is over 18 million. What about New Zealand? It's about 830 membership in New Zealand, that's North and South Island, in 1915. And today, it's something in the order of 12,000. So we can thank God for the blessings as he bestowed us on our parts. But our challenge is still great, because we have to share the message to the whole world. And it's my prayer that we might be able to do that. Yes, we're just a small percentage of the total world's population, but we're not that insignificant, really. Not really. And to promote our outreach, we will now take our mission offering. Will be collected by our deacons. Later on, during the talk, Pastor's talk, we'll also have an offering bag, which will be the expense offering, which will be used for our local church. So we'll take up this mission offering now. Thank you. Just pray briefly for the offering. Father in heaven, we thank you again that we can be part of thy church. We thank you again that we can offer an offering for outreach, for the mission areas. We know that the work is great, and we want to see Jesus coming hastened. It's our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Our time now will be given over to Pastor Laurie McMurtry, who has been a pastor here, and I think he'll have something interesting. I'm sure he'll take us down memory lane. Thank you so much, Pastor.
Well, good morning. Thank you for joining with us this morning. And it's lovely to be back in the Royal Oak Church. There were some interesting times that we had when we were here. Challenging times. And as I look back over those days, it was a time of involvement of all the church. It was a very exciting, challenging but exciting. Everybody in the church got behind the project to build this church. And we ran all manner of different projects. People had their individual projects, and the church as a whole ran projects. And it was to prove to be very, very successful. It united the people. We had a vision, and the Lord blessed that vision, very much so. Today, this is a reminder that God blesses people who trust Him. Yes. A number of years ago, before I came to this church, I was traveling in America, and I wanted to go to a particular place where Henry Ford used to work. And I had heard so much of Henry Ford, and we went to that great institution. We went to his little cottage where he lived and worked. And then above his desk, I took a copy of his motto. And if ever a motto is one that you and I ought to apply, it is the motto that Henry Ford followed. It is based upon the word enthusiasm. This is Henry Ford's motto. Enthusiasm is the yeast that makes your hope rise to the stars. Enthusiasm is the sparkle in your eye. It is the swing in your gait. It is the grip of your hand. The irresistible urge of your will and your energy to execute your ideas. Enthusiasts are fighters. They have fortitude. They have staying qualities. Enthusiasm is at the bottom of all progress. With it, there is accomplishment. Without it, there are only alibis. Good motto? Well, it's one that I sort of felt was very important that we as a people should follow, particularly in the challenge that we had of building this building. Now, I don't know what this place is worth now. I would estimate probably in the several million. But it was built by people who did small projects, but everybody was involved. Yes. And one of the great avenues of this church was prayer. I don't know how many of you get at prayer meeting now, but we used to have a prayer meeting during the week, and we would have pretty well all the church there. We would have anything up to 80 people, parents with their children, and it was a time of seeking the Lord and getting blessed by the Lord. The prayer meetings became the motivating power behind the scenes that gave us the drive and the enthusiasm that we needed to fulfill the task that God gave to us. Prayer, I always have believed, is the great avenue that we individually neglect. You know, Satan is a very clever being. He doesn't mind you coming to church, by the way. He doesn't mind you listening to the sermon, but he does not like you living what you hear, and he does not like you praying. The greatest avenue, the greatest gift, the greatest power that we have is the power of prayer, and I'm afraid it is the most neglected of gifts. Satan tries to keep us so busy that we neglect this gift. I want to share with you an incident that happened a number of years ago while I was here. And I see Laurel Woolley down there. One day I came to the church and she gave me a letter. I'm going to read the letter to you. Before I do that, let me tell you a little of the background. We were well into this project. The bill seemed to mount up, and Satan closed in on me and tried to suggest that the project was impossible. You can never generate the funds that you need. And I knew that I would need the enlightening power of God to enable us to do this job. And so I prayed that the Lord would intervene and show that He was in charge of this project, not me. That day, Laurel, who was our church clerk, received a letter, and when I came to church that Sabbath, she handed it to me. I want to read some of the things in the letter and then just explain it to you. By the way, the person who wrote this letter was not a member of our church here. He belonged to the Tauranga church. I had never seen him in our church. I had been to Tauranga some 2 years before on a commission that I had with the Church of Trust Services. I took the church service that morning, and in the afternoon I shared with the people of that church the way the Lord had blessed us here at Royal Oak. I met this man for the first time that day, 2 years before, and I never saw him again. But here, on this time when the challenges were on, he wrote a letter to me. And I'll read the letter to you. Dear Pastor McMurtry, I was lying awake the other night thinking about the blessings which the Lord has given to us when I was inspired to send this check to your building fund. Then he goes on a bit more, and then he says, it was the inspiration from your meeting or your testimony which inspired my thinking. Wishing your church and your family God's richest blessing. And he signed it. The check was for several hundred dollars. It didn't solve our financial problem, but what did it do? It told us that God was in charge. And that was made all the difference. Interesting, isn't it? Here was a person I'd met 2 years before, spoken to in a church service, and then on the time of challenge, inspired to write a check and send it to me for our building fund. Does God work in mysterious ways? He does indeed, doesn't he? Yes. Well, I have here a little book, Table Talk. Have you seen that? Well, we ought to see it because it involved a lot of work by a lot of people. It's a vegetarian cookery book that our church committee made right back there in the 70s. And we sold it to raise funds for our church. And we have a copy at home, and I'm staying with Roger and Greta, and they still have their copy. They made all manner of projects to generate funds, and it's just amazing. Here I have a little tape that was made by a group of our singers, Royal Oak in Music. They prepared a tape of music. All of these are points, of course, were to enable us to generate the funds that we need to build this place. You know, we did not have any great wealthy people in our midst. We only received small donations from generous people. We had no wealthy person that would give us $50,000, but we did have people who were prepared to give regularly every week. We did have people who were prepared to get behind projects and enable those projects to generate the funds that we needed. It was a challenging time, but indeed a very rewarding time. And it is, well, it's very rewarding to stand in this beautiful church, and I, quite frankly, perhaps I'm prejudiced. I don't think there are any churches, to my mind, that are more attractive than this particular one. But that's my thinking. It's a beautiful church. And it involves the thousands of hours and time and prayers and monies that we all put in to make it what it is. Indeed, it was a challenging but a very satisfying project that we involved in. The I just have a note here of some of the things that happened during the project, and I'd like to share a few of these things because you had to live through that time to know just the challenge, but also the blessings that the challenge gave to us. You know, as I said, when we had prayer meetings, we were getting, most of the church coming to prayer meeting. And that was very, very exciting, very rewarding, because the people drew together and the Lord blessed us because of it. You remember Margaret Howie? Well, this is what Margaret had to say. My most vivid memory of spending money, making money or spending money quicker than we made it. That's where faith came in. Faith to allow us to buy bricks in advance, to order portals and have the delivery before the firm went broke, to purchase an organ we never wanted meant to buy, to have our lights and carpets made to order because nothing seemed quite right. The list is endless, because the Lord blessed the faithfulness of his people and their support of the project. I remember an elderly so clearly that many working bees we had. In fact, when I arrived in Australia, I had difficulty in realising that I had some Sundays available to do what I liked. But those thousands of hours that were spent by all and sundry in the church on those projects must have saved constructional costs well over $100,000. We must appreciate the many people who had the necessary building talents, who gave us willingly of their time to help us finish the job. Now, one of the great features of this church is that window up there. Russell, would you like and your wife like to come and tell us a little bit about this window? There's a real story here. Let's just... I'm not sure one of those work.
Where would you like us to start?
Not at the end.
Before we start on the window, you were silly asking us up here.
Oh, I know that, but I take it.
I think you ought to know that when we first came here, we had $10,000 to build a church. And I remember Laurie talking to the business meeting and saying, are you serious about this church or are you not? Because if you are, we need to do something about it. And 10,000, and what we need to do about it is we need to boost up the prayer meeting first. Said, if we concentrate on raising funds, we'll go on collecting money for years and years and years and never get anywhere. But our emphasis needs to be on developing our relationship with God, and the prayer meeting is the way to do it. And we did that. And then Beth's nodding down there, but she was part of that as well. And she started a sharing time. And at first it was only Beth ever got up to share. But after a few weeks, we had people standing up, so many that we had to restrict the time. Otherwise, we would have taken the whole service every week with people sharing things about that were happening in their lives as a result of the blessing of God. And when you're talking about the man from Tauranga, I remember that, but I think one that was even more amazing was a man that used to drive past here on Mount Smart Road every day to work. Not an Adventist, we had no connection with the church at all, but he stopped by one day and donated $1,000 to the church building because he felt impressed to do so. There were so many others. I could keep you entertained with stories for ages, but let's talk about the window. Laurel, you can start.
Well, Russell was on the building committee, and I know that the committee was keen to do something nice with this wall. It's the main feature wall. Talked about a stained glass window, but felt they couldn't afford that. And Russell comes from Christchurch. We went down there Christmas holidays to visit family. And while we were down there, we were just roaming around the town one day and came across a place that was kind of an art centre where lots of different artists had quarters. And we went in there to have a look and discovered there a place that did stained glass work. And yes, the technique was from Holland, I think, 300-year-old technique where they actually had the colour in the glass rather than just sandblasted onto it. And so Russell started to talk with the owner there and told him what we wanted to do here.
Yeah, well, we came back and, we discussed what we were going to do up here for two years before this. And decided that we didn't have enough money. We'd like to put stained glass up there, but we didn't have enough money for that. But when I came back from this and mentioned it, they said, oh, let's look at it again, because we've got a bit more money now than we had then. And so we looked at it and said, well, yeah, we may be able to, let's see what he can do. And so I contacted him and asked him what he could do there. He drew up a pencil drawing of what you see up above us here.
You'd send him some Bible verses.
I know, not yet. Yeah, he just said a round window would be what he thought. And then we said, okay, if you send me down some text, I'll draw up for you what I think will fit there. And we did that. On the second coming, and he sent us down the drawing. We liked it, gave him the commission, and he then made the window. But there was a sequel to that, which I told some of you here before, but we happened to be visiting Japan in 1985, and we met two people on a railway station up in Sendai, and of course they were the only other Europeans there, so we started chatting, and when we mentioned we were from Christchurch, she said, oh, I had a brother who lived in Christchurch. I said, oh, what did he do there? And she said he made stained glass. And it turned out that her brother was the man who designed the window and made the window, and she said that he had won a scholarship to study architecture and was now an architect in Canada as a result of this commission here. So there we go.
She was so excited that she was going to contact this brother, tell him that here we are, we'd met on this little train station and in Japan, and there was that common link. And so, she was very excited, and we were just blown away.
Beautiful. Well, thank you both very much.
No, you don't need that.
No. Before I was a Seventh-day Adventist, I was in business. We had a family business, and when I became an Adventist, there were certain disruptions. Namely, I went to Avondale to study for ministry. My brother continued to run the business. After a few years, as we returned home, we have a birthday only a few days apart, and we were in the middle of this building project, and suddenly I had a brilliant idea. I sent him a plan of this desk for his birthday. I said, I'm sending you a plan for the desk which I want you to make for your birthday. And so he did that. He had his men make the desk, so the desk we had has got a little bit of significance because my brother had it made for us in particular. Well, there was Beth, you better come and tell us a little bit about this cooking project. One of the projects that we had, and we had, we don't really have time this morning to cover them all, but we did have the cooking project was one of our major projects, and perhaps you might tell us a little bit about it, Beth.
Well, there were so many people involved in cooking here. I know that the Woolies, for instance, were leading up our catering committee. And if I remember correctly, when you moved away, that I took over the leadership. And many people helped us. It wasn't a one-person show by any means. The church was really behind us with a lot of hard work, but how significant it was. But there was also a project which I was involved initially with Pat Tullock. And we would cook, I think on a Thursday, if I remember correctly, for the staff at the sanitarium, and probably Roger organised it. I'm not sure who organised it initially, but the staff would send in their orders, and we would make three different items of food for their lunch. When Pat moved away to Australia, I took it over, and we would make, or I'd make, pizzas, savoury rice, and pastas, all vegetarian. And one day, I remember, I made 100 pizzas. Now, that didn't happen every day. Consequently, I don't think I eat pizzas today. But it was a great project, kept us very busy, and but it was rewarding for the church. And it was a privilege to take part in it.
Thank you. Well, there were many, many projects. Those of you who were here at that time, and there's only a few of you, would remember the date packing project? Tom Ellison, of SHF fame, made some contact for the church to pack dates in small containers on a Sunday. We did this for three Sundays in a row. And the fascinating thing was that the majority of the church, we opened at 8 o'clock in the morning, we went through to 7 o'clock at night on Sundays. People would come and go as they had time. And we packed thousands of packets of dates. But we made on the first week, or on the 3 weeks, we made between $650 and $800 a day. Now, that might not be a lot of money, but 40 years ago, it was quite a lot of money. Yeah. Yeah. Right. Okay. 73. Wow. That's a good sort of a project, isn't it? 73 people coming out for a project, yeah. Well, as we it was a tremendous time of working together. When we first introduced the idea that we were going to build a new church. Now, the older church, of course, had a history. There were people in that church who had been members since the day it was born or built. And there was a reaction by some of them against destroying the old church and building a new one. In fact, one of the prominent ladies in the church stood up at the business meeting and said, "You will build a new church over my dead body." Well, we very tactfully didn't argue. We carried on with our projects. When we came down to the date packing, as we said, you know, 70 or 80 people turned up. This lady, who had been so vitriolic against the idea of a new church, she came along and she helped. And from that time on, she was a supporter rather than a critic. Well, interesting times. Yes. A couple of our members started a garden. Remember Ewan Harden, Neville Britton? Brother Harden came to me one day and said, look, he said, I don't have much money. He said, I don't have any, but he said, I do know how to grow vegetables. He said, if you can get some land for me, which I can grow vegetables, I'll grow vegetables and sell them for the building fund. Well, I don't know whether it was Roger, but certainly someone from the SHF persuaded the SHF to let him use some of the land that was opposite the factory. And so these men turned it into a garden. And each week they would bring produce along and sell it. And that, of course, all went into the building fund. Yeah, it was a challenging time. You know, you just imagine even in church today, you have many more members, getting 80-odd people along to a prayer meeting. There was a sense of, unity, vision, excitement, wanting to do things. And what was happening is really, I believe, what we as a church should be aiming for today. One of the interesting little projects that young people ran to generate some funds was a barrow-a-thon to Helensville. And a lot of young people pushed barrows from here to and generating funds, getting people to sponsor them. And so these young people pushed barrows to Helensville. Mm. Now, Russell Woolley, who stood up before, he made a statement which I noticed, and I'm going to share it with you. He probably doesn't even remember making this, but this is what Russell said. It came out in the notes on the church building. When the church as a whole puts spiritual things first, the financial blessings follow. Would you agree with that? That's true, isn't it? Indeed, that's what we tried to do. We tried to get our priorities right, and the Lord blessed us financially. We did. What an amazing time we had. I'm excited to see that we still have our carpet. Now, it's not a new carpet now, but it's showing a little wear in places. But this was one which we spent much time and prayer and thought over. And because of the size of the project, they made this particularly for us. And I'm excited to see that it still plays such a prominent part in our church. Mm. We had some disappointments. We had to buy a piece of land at the back of the church. And I think it was $11,000, yes. The trouble is that we had once owned that land. And at a time of, difficulty, the church had decided to sell it. And they sold it for a few hundred pounds. And we had to pay $11,000 to get it back again. Well, you know, sometimes we do make mistakes. Do you remember Jerry Ping? Eh? Actually, Jerry Ping was the first man to challenge me with the building project. The first Sabbath I was here, I knew Jerry, he had, he fronted me up and he said, the project that we want you to do more than anything else is to build a new church. And he started the ball rolling. By the way, Jerry Ping is a self-supporting missionary to China. He used to work for the Sanitarium Health Food Company. A number of years ago, he upstaked, sold everything he had, went to China, and spends his time over there as a missionary, a self-supporting missionary in China. Beth and I had the privilege of going to China a few years ago. We stayed with Jerry. He showed us around, and we even had the opportunity of addressing one of his meetings on a Saturday afternoon. It was a very interesting, you know, in this country, we accept the word of God and we know it's there, but in a place like China, the people went desperately wanting to know a purpose in life. They run church services in their churches from sun up to sundown on Saturday morning, on Saturday. It's one service after another. And one church we went to at the on the morning service, the at the end of the church, we had a translator that translated what they were speaking. They made an appeal, and about 40 to 50 people stood. And we said to our associate, "What's going on?" "Oh, he's just made a call for baptism. And those 40 or 50 people have just stood for baptism." And she said to us, "Next week he'll make another call. And another group will stand up." I said, "What, the same group?" "Oh no," she said, "there'll be more." And you know, it was an exciting project. We, Jerry ran a meeting on the Sabbath afternoon in which we had the opportunity to address. He translated because half the people could only speak Chinese. And you know, if we had responded to them, I think we'd be still there talking to them. They had so many questions. They wanted to know so much. You know, they were what the Bible calls thirsty. They were hungry. They wanted to know what the purpose of life was all about. And it was very, very moving to have that opportunity. Well, Jerry Peng, the man from this church, headed up that project in China, and he's still working over there today, supporting himself and using what he generates over there to be a self-supporting missionary. Yes. I will remember, Russell made mention of the fundraising committee. I will remember the first meeting I met when I was here with the fundraising committee. Now, up until that time, they had been raising money, but not with an express purpose of building a new church. So I asked them, "Well, how much do you usually raise?" And they said, "Oh, usually about $2,000 or $3,000 a year." I said, "Well, what do you think you could raise if you really set your heart to it?" And someone said, "Oh, I think we'd get three, all right." And no one said four. And then I challenged them to raise in the next 12 months $20,000. There was suddenly a silence. No one was rude enough to want to argue, but it was just amazing. When we started, the Lord started to open doors. When we did our part, He blessed us. And not only did we achieve the aim, but we went on year after year to extend and eclipse that aim. Yes, it was an exciting project because we had no big money behind us. All we had was people who had the faith to believe that God would hear their prayers and bless them if they did their part. And indeed, He did. There's a statement from Desire of Ages, which I think is very appropriate. "With Him, there can be no such thing as failure, loss, impossibility, or defeat. We can do all things through Him who strengthens us." You know, that's a promise for the church, and it's a promise for each of us individually. If we trust the Lord, He will give to us the power to do what He wants us to do. He opens doors and that we never believe were there. And we as a church have to realize that in the times in which we live in, the Lord is showing that we are in the last days. Not only do we need to be ready for those things that are coming upon the earth, but we in our turn need to be the means of helping others, that they might be able to share that which we have. Yes. I wonder, those of you who were there in those days could remember the Youth Congress. Yeah, there was a Youth Congress being held, and we decided that we would put a quote in to erect all the tents, and that we would become assistant caterers, that we would do all the tables and all the dishwashing. And so we had a team of people from this church who went that go, and we made several thousand dollars by doing these interesting and humbling tasks. But a blessing it was, it united the people. Yeah. I will remember Sister Pierce. Sister Pierce lived through to be 100 years of age, and she it was who was one of those who turned the first sod in the preparing of this building, dear old Sister Pierce. She gave very generously of her means to make this church a reality. Yes. We think of so many people who had a part to play. I went to visit a church member one day, and in doing so, I called in to speak to her husband. Now, her husband was an upholsterer. He was not a church member, but we were on good terms. I went into his workshop and spent some time with him. And then he said, well, what are you doing for this building fund? And I said, oh, well, we're raising funds. He said, could you use any vinyl? I said, I didn't know what we do with vinyl. I said, of course we can use vinyl. He said, well, he said, just have a look up on the ceiling of this my workshop. And I looked up there, and there was a mountain of vinyl. He had been there for 30 years, and every time he finished a job and he had leftover vinyl, he'd put it up on the ceiling. And so he had a mountain of vinyl. So we took all this vinyl and we gave it to the ladies of the church. They organised a working bees. They sorted through, got rid of the stuff that was no good, and they made what did they make? Purses, book covers, directory covers, bookmarks, shopping bags, and moccasins. Oh yes, we had quite a business in making moccasins from this vinyl. Well, that was just another one of the many projects. See, the exciting thing about these days that we had a church where everyone caught the vision. It wasn't just some people sitting back and saying, oh, well, you do it, we'll watch. Everybody was involved. And we sit in a church today that is the result of that unity of effort, that vision, that hard work, that generous giving. For indeed, as we gave, the Lord indeed blessed. He blessed very, not only us materially, but certainly blessed us as a church. Yes, we had, in a previous life, amongst some of my limited talents, I had been an auctioneer. And so we had a number of auctions while I was here. We had cake auctions and all manner of auctions, generating funds for the building fund. And we had a lot of fun with them. And I was just reading here, Dennis Steely made a plaque, and it was auctioned and re-auctioned several times. And on one occasion, a humble green plant in a margarine container was sold to Gwen Pullen. Remember Gwen? Yes. Well, she protested that she didn't want it, but she paid for it and she put it up and we sold it again. And I think we sold the thing three times before someone finally took the thing away. But it was a time of great excitement and interest, and we had time to really see how these all things all fitted in together. It was a time of enthusiasm, of warmth, of unity of purpose. And that's really where it was. We had a vision of a church. that we wanted to build. We all caught that vision and we all worked towards it. You know, we live in an interesting time. I believe the Lord would have been here now if the church had aroused to do that which God wants it to do. We have a task to take the gospel to the world, and we will never do it unless we catch the vision and the enthusiasm and believe that God will empower us. You know, each one of us rubs shoulders with people who will ever know about Jesus Christ from us. No one else can take our place. And if we don't share with them, they will never know. It's a sobering thought, but it is a reminder of the power of witness. Let me tell you a story of a lady that I met that went to this church. She was a lady who had been a church member for many years, but she had become involved in an illicit relationship. She knew it was wrong, but she still didn't want to give it up. And so she lived in Auckland. And what she would do, she would go to a church for a few weeks. She still thought it was right to go to church. And then after she got known, she would shift off to another church, which she would do. And this went on for some time, until the day that she came to this church. It was when the old church was here. Now, I'm not sure if you knew, but the old church, when we met on Sabbath, the church was full, and we had to have people chairs in the foyer because there was not enough room in the church. She came to the church a little late that day, and the church was full, and the foyer seemed to be full as well. She thought, I don't have to go to church today, I can go home. Then one of our deacons saw her and spoke to her and said, would you like me to find a seat for you? And she said, all right, okay. So he went down the aisle and finally got to one of the pews and asked the people to shift along and made room, went back and got her, took her down and seated her. And then a hymn was announced. She stood up and he noticed that she didn't have a hymnal. He got a hymnal and took it down to her. She said, do you know, that man does not know that those two acts completely changed my attitude to God. I saw that people were interested and would help me and went out of their way to do so. That was to change the whole direction of my life. I put aside those things that were wrong, and it all hinged upon a person, by the way, who never knew what he had done, because she didn't want him to know. Interesting how these things happen, isn't it? Yes. You know, sometimes the things that appear hopeless are some of our greatest blessings. As I mentioned before I was an Adventist, I in part was an auctioneer. And there were occasions when we would be rung by the public trustee and told that to go to a certain place and empty the contents of the house, take them down to the auction mart and have them sold. That gave us the discretion to, if there was stuff that was no good, to be able to throw it out. We went to this house this day, and I will never forget this situation. It had been closed up for some time. The widower had been without his wife for some 12 years, I think it was. And he had just existed. It was the most untidy place. On the table were still the bereavement cards from his late wife. We looked through this place, it was littered with dust and dirt and rubbish everywhere. And we thought, well, get the cleaners in and just get rid of it all. Then I noticed amongst the grime a china cabinet. I opened it and I nearly fell over. The china cabinet was full of Wedgwood, Royal Doulton, Spode, stuff, beautiful stuff, covered in dust and dirt, but worth a fortune. We took the contents of that place, and it was a very, very valuable for the estate. But you know, there is a message in that. You and I rub shoulders with people. We wipe them off, saying, "Oh, so and so couldn't possibly be interested in what we believe." How foolish! Sometimes the most unpromising exterior hides a person who is desperately looking for a purpose in life. When I first entered a Seventh-day Adventist church a number of years ago, I nearly fell over. For most of the people in that church were my customers. And I said to them, "Do you mean to say that you've known all about this and you never mentioned it once to me?" You know what they said? "We never thought you'd be interested." How many people do you rub shoulders with that you say, "I'm sure they would never be interested"? Well, I'm proof to show that a person who didn't appear to be interested was underneath desperately looking for a purpose in life. You rub shoulders with people who are similarly inclined. They are enclosed with challenges and problems and the worries of the world. They're not sure where the answers are, and they're not quite sure what the purpose in life is. But we do know there is a purpose in life, and we need to be people who can witness and share, because we have good news to share, not bad, good news. We have a God who is interested in us, a God who knows more about us than we know about ourselves, a God who is inclined to guide and lead if we will but listen and guide him and be guided by him. Yes. Got some notes here. I just must check and make sure that I've covered most points. I have here a copy of a summary of all the things that were happening in the church at the time of this building work piece, and I was here for 6.5 years, and we had a wonderful and challenging time, and it's very exciting to see the end results, and it's still so beautiful today. It was a time where there certainly were challenges. The contractor that made our trusses went into receivership, and our trusses were being stored, waiting to be erected, on his premises. And the initial people wanted to confiscate our trusses as part of the failed business. Fortunately, with some God-guided negotiations, we were able to get them without losing them, as we could have well done. I believe the Lord showed that He was with us. Indeed, He had His hand over us, and it was indeed a great and wonderful blessing. All right, well, I think that is, in brief, a summary of what happened over 6.5 years. And I think today we are enjoying a reminder that over the 100 years that this church has been going, some of the most exciting and challenging times that we had were the times that we built this church. But not only is it a very beautiful church, but it is and will be for a continuing witness to the Lord in this area. May God bless you.
We invite you to stand as we sing a final hymn, "We Have This Hope."
Shall we bow our heads for prayer? Mighty Heavenly Father, we come before you. We thank you, Father, for bringing us today. Father, we thank you for the sharing, Lord, of how you have led this church to this far. Father, we look forward for your second coming, and we just pray that may you help us, Lord, to be faithful. Help us, Lord, to reach out to the community and to reach out to other people, that your coming might be soon. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.